The year was 1857, and the Second Opium War was raging between China and the combined forces of the English and French. It was one of the many bloody colonial wars fought over resources like tea, sugar, and the intoxicating opium poppy. It was a war fought by peasants and noblemen alike. One of these aristocratic soldiers was the noble Lord Theodore Thomas Blackwood, the quintessential English gentleman and explorer. While his fellow soldiers cowered behind cover, Lord Blackwood charged into the fray, shouldering his rifle and firing his pistol into the crowd of opposing soldiers. It was the Battle of Canton, one of the most crucial battles of the entire conflict. The French and English were laying siege to the city of Canton, also known as Guangzhou, to prove their military dominance and capture an important Chinese government official. Lord Blackwood led the charge on horseback. Every bullet seemed to find the heart of a foe. He was a true hero among men, a gentleman warrior with class, refinement, and style. And it would be thanks to his expert leadership and marksmanship on the field that the Allied European forces won the battle decisively. Lord Theodore Thomas Blackwood is a name that deserves to be counted among Lord Horatio Nelson, Sir Francis Bacon, and Sir Walter Raleigh. In addition to being a skilled and honorable fighter, Lord Blackwood is a consummate explorer, naturalist, and frontiersman. During his heyday, he traveled perhaps further than any man across the known and unknown corners of the globe. He made scientific, biological, and anthropological discoveries that should have reset the course of society forever. And yet, you won't find any records in the history books of Lord Theodore Thomas Blackwood, nor will you find any grand oil paintings or dedicated wings in British museums. This is because Lord Theodore Thomas Blackwood is a 4.5-inch telepathic neon sea slug, and he's known to the SCP Foundation as SCP-1867. While he would never admit to it, Lord Blackwood belongs to the species Nembrotha kubariana, also known as the variable neon slug. He's kept in a standard aquarium in a Foundation containment site, and is physically no different to any other member of his species. What makes Lord Blackwood unique is his powerful telepathic abilities, specifically, the power to communicate by speaking directly into people's minds. And what's more, he's extremely talkative. But to what extent is anything that this anomalous sea slug says true? Or is he just like SCP-082 Ferdinand the Cannibal, a creative and pathological liar? It isn't committed to record how exactly the Foundation discovered Lord Blackwood. Perhaps a local aquarium worker worried they were going insane when they heard the voice of a 19th century English nobleman ringing in their ears whenever they were cleaning algae out of the tank. Maybe Lord Blackwood was found by SCP Foundation divers, who are constantly combing the ocean for anomalous creatures and activity. What we do know is that Lord Blackwood is an incredibly strange and mysterious individual. He claims to have visited locations all around the world, and encountered rare societies and creatures. The Foundation was skeptical about a number of Lord Blackwood's more outlandish claims, on account of him being a sea slug, but he does appear to have the knowledge to back up his supposed experience. Interviews with Lord Blackwood have shown that he's extremely knowledgeable in the areas of geography, zoology, botany, archaeology, anthropology, and linguistics relating to his claimed regions of exploration, as well as more esoteric fields such as obscure mythology, mysticism, and cryptozoology. In other words, if Lord Blackwood hadn't gone on his escapades around the globe throughout history, how would he have come to possess this wide variety of information? The Foundation was getting frustrated, and began to probe further into the personal life of the most interesting gastropod in containment. Lord Blackwood, under questioning, was always polite and amicable with Foundation staff. He seemed to display no real knowledge of the fact that he himself was a sea slug, going as far to accuse other people of being crazy or drunk when they brought the fact up to him. While none of Lord Blackwood's tall tales ever extend past the year 1910, he told fanciful stories of exploring the Americas and of his involvement in the Second Opium War on the side of the English. Naturally, the Foundation wanted proof. When they pressured Lord Blackwood on this, something even stranger happened. He gave it. The Lord told his interviewers that he would happily donate his collection to them if it gave them cause to believe what he was saying. He gave the baffled Foundation researchers the address of a cottage in England where they could find the secrets to his bizarre and mysterious past. and local agents in the area followed up on the information. Upon investigation, Foundation field agents did indeed find the cottage that Lord Blackwood had specified. It was being maintained by an extremely old woman. When questioned about her presence there, she said that she was keeping the house for Lord Blackwood and gave no more useful information. Incidentally, it appears that this singular purpose was all that this old woman was living for. She abruptly passed away from heart failure 5 days after the Foundation commandeered the cottage. Whether anything truly anomalous caused this, we still do not know. At first, the cottage seemed normal, until the field agents discovered a secret basement housing Lord Blackwood's collection. They were amazed at what they saw. The basement consisted of zoological and botanical specimens, over 3,000 artifacts, a library containing over 5,000 items, and a functioning 1800s scientific laboratory. It took about 3 weeks for Foundation agents working round the clock in shifts to remove all the items from Lord Blackwood's mysterious collection, and what they found raised even more questions. The collection included, but was no means limited to, 116 unknown species of plants, 107 unknown species of insects, 28 unknown species of lizards, 23 unknown species of fish, 14 unknown species of amphibians, 12 unknown species of mammals, fossils pertaining to 8 unknown species of dinosaur, fossils pertaining to 12 unknown species of prehistoric mammal, and artifacts belonging to 29 unknown indigenous societies. That's a lot of unknowns. But wait, there's more. His collection also contained a collection of seemingly unknown firearms, including 3 wide-bore muskets marked as Dr. B.T. Moth's effective particle destabilizers, detailed globes of Mercury, Venus, Mars, and the Galilean moons, accompanied by notes detailing possible paths of surface exploration, a heavily modified carriage containing instruments of unknown purpose. A note attached to the door reads, "On the Fritz, speak with Henry," and a highly dangerous and seemingly anomalous machine that killed 4 Foundation field agents before it was destroyed on site. And when questioned about this little fiasco, Lord Blackwood responded, "I did warn you to be careful around my collection. That bloody thing nearly took my head off back in 97 when I found it." However, there was one thing recovered from Lord Blackwood's collection that was perhaps more interesting than all the others. 35 handwritten journals containing recordings of events described by Lord Blackwood in his grandiose tall tales to the Foundation researchers. The accounts are generally identical to the stories he had told, save for some slight variations and exaggerations on the part of Blackwood in the retelling. Most interestingly of all of these journals have been dated to the appropriate time period of the events described by Foundation scientists. While his stories are too numerous to all be shared here, there's one that perfectly sums them all up. Lord Blackwood's account of a possible encounter with SCP-1000, also known as Bigfoot, in Seattle during the mid-1800s. Lord Blackwood, seeking to explore the so-called New World of North America, embarked with an assistant and an indigenous American guide to the Pacific Northwest in search of the legendary Sasquatch. The trio was headed for Mount Rainier, then known as Tahoma. During the journey, Lord Blackwood found a young fox caught in a trap that had been set by a local tribe. He took sympathy on the animal and freed it, allowing it to run away to safety. That night, he and his assistant met up with the rest of his guide's tribe, and they settled down for the evening. However, things took a disastrous turn when the camp was raided by a rival tribe. Almost everyone was slaughtered in the process, and Lord Blackwood and his 2 companions were hauled away by the enemy tribe for a sinister purpose: sacrifice to a violent local deity. As it turns out, the creature that this tribe worshipped was the very same one Lord Blackwood and the others were trying to find, a particularly large and aggressive Sasquatch. Each night, a different sacrifice was made to the Sasquatch. The victim would be placed near a forest clearing while the tribe played a primal song, and the Sasquatch would emerge from the trees to devour its prey. The first night, it ate the assistant. The next night, it ate the guide, and then it became time for the sacrifice of Lord Blackwood himself. As Blackwood was presented for sacrifice, he accepted his fate. But instead of the Sasquatch, a legion of woodland animals emerged from the trees. Foxes, elks, raccoons, and more, themselves painted with tribal symbols. The animals seemed to be on Lord Blackwood's side, and attacked the tribe's people who had been holding him captive, giving Blackwood the chance to flee into the forest during the chaos. Later, these same animals would find Blackwood again and present him with things his captors had stolen from him. An elder fox also gave him a letter, proclaiming him a knight of their people now. He was allowed safe passage back to a nearby settlement, at which point he wrote to his financiers back in England, explaining the situation and asking for more money to perform further expeditions into the Tahoma region. The whole incident had only increased his thirst for adventure and exploration. Whether this tale is actually true, or just a bizarre colonial fantasy from the pathological mind of a telepathic sea slug, we may never know. But it doesn't make it any less interesting. To this day, Lord Blackwood continues to be a perplexing but fascinating anomaly. He may not be the most dangerous, and he may not be the most useful either, but there's no denying that perhaps we'd all like to sit next to his tank for a couple hours one day and hear him spin a good yarn over a warm cup of tea. Now go check out SCP-1007 Mr. Life and Mr. Death and SCP-4205 In the Eyes of the Beholder for more mysterious entities contained by the SCP Foundation.